is the CBC Evening News.
Very good evening to you. I'm Lisa Broom. We begin tonight with news of that court appearance by the nursing aide accused of mistreating an elderly resident of a nursing home.
I beat somebody. No, that's my face, yeah.
Ariel King, seen in the video apparently kicking and heckling an elderly woman at a Christchurch nursing home, was released on $3,000 bail. The elderly woman, identified as 84-year-old Jasmine Hall, is a resident at the Roseville Home for the Elderly where King worked. Police say the incident happened on April 28th this year. Now, when she appeared in court, 37-year-old King was accompanied by her mother and son. As the group left, they were met with harsh comments from bystanders gathered in the yard of the court. It eventually led to King's son and several people having a heated exchange of words. The video, which has been making the rounds on the various social media platforms, received over 1 million views on Facebook. King of Lynch's St. Philip is expected to reappear in the District C Magistrates Court on May 23rd.
A St. John youth was before the court today on gun and ammunition charges. He is 29-year-old Randy Kimar Phillips of Carters. Phillips is on charges of unlawful possession of a .38 handgun and unlawful possession of ammunition. Now, according to police, members of the Tactical Response Unit were carrying out an operation at the Glebe in St. John on Monday when Phillips was observed running from the area. Phillips was pursued, held, and a search of his person yielded the firearm with 6 rounds hidden in his pants. Barbados may soon be in a better position to get a speedier access to justice. That's because the Jurist Project is working on new ways to deliver a timely, transparent, and effective justice system. This, according to High Commissioner of Canada, Richard Hanley. He was speaking at a workshop hosted by the Jurist Project at the Lloyd Erskine Sandiford Centre this morning. The High Commissioner says the seminar is aimed at distributing fairness.
The Impact Justice Project, also valued at $33 million Barbados dollars and implemented by the UE Cave Hill campus through its Caribbean Law Institute Center, is aimed at ensuring better access to justice for vulnerable and marginalized communities in the CARICOM region, as well as by governments, the private sector, and civil society as a whole.
Well, Barbados's economy appears to have turned the corner with activity picking up. That's the assessment of the International Monetary Fund released today as the IMF completed its Article 4 mission to Barbados. The IMF team was led by Deputy Division Chief Judith Gold between May 9th and today to conduct the discussions. In her statement, Ms. Gold says real GDP grew by 0.8% in 2015. She says this was underpinned by a surge in tourism arrivals relative to 0.2% in 2014 and an average of minus 0.3% in 2008 to 2014. She adds that employment increased by 2% while unemployment fell. However, Ms. Gold also says that the economy still faces serious challenges. She says while growth has resumed and short-term prospects are positive, imbalances persist between available resources and government programs. Minister of Labour, Senator Dr. Esther Bayer-Suku, wants the World Skills Programme to become bigger and better. She addressed the competing students at their awards ceremony at the Lloyd Erskine Sandiford Centre this week.
The competition this year was the closest Barbados has ever come to using the international standards for test projects. And Labour Minister Senator Dr. Esther Bayer-Suku says the project will fall right in line by the next World Skills in 2018.
That is when we will know that Barbados is ready to send a full team of competitors to World Skills America's competition. And then from there, of course, you know where we have our eyes set. We will be set to go to World Skills International.
World Skills allows students under 22 to prove their technical and vocational skills. The local finals were last weekend, and Samuel Jackman Prescott Polytechnic and the Barbados Vocational Training Board split the first prizes in half. From the BBTB, Tanisha Hall topped the culinary section while her colleague Takia Jordan won gold in ladies and men's hair dressing. From the SJPP, Rashida Griffith claimed top prize in garment making, and Akil Craig Brown who also gained Best Overall Competitor, was first in automotive technology. Brenda Pope, who represented the main sponsor, KPMG, says automotive it's important technology to support youth who do positive things, and she invited more sponsors to get on board.
This will allow the organization to both widen the set of skills examined and also send a larger team or contingent to both the regional and global competitions.
She advised finalists to carry a positive attitude into the world of work and to take advantage of all opportunities.
If you can't get a job, don't sit back and do nothing. Instead, volunteer at a not-for-profit like WordSkills or even seek an unpaid position.
The TVET Council is the principal organizer for WorldSkills Barbados, and its deputy chairman believes the competition has a bright future.
We expect to soon embark on research intended to measure the impact of WorldSkills and the other TVET Council programs on the local technical and vocational education and training system.
In the future, finalists will have to reach 75% to medal, even if they come within the top three, to ensure they're fit to compete overseas. Denise Blackman, CBC News.
The Code Sprint program, Barbados's first ever mobile application competition, has come to an end, and creators of the app Carib Auto Express are the winners.
The competition, which saw five teams of mobile app entrepreneurs pitch their ideas to a panel of judges, climaxed on Sunday at the University of the West Indies. The mobile app idea spanned areas such as weather, sports, and e-commerce. Team leader of Carib Auto Express, Mark Laurent, gave a brief explanation.
This is a store-to-door service for mechanics and hobbyists, which gives them the confidence to shop and have parts delivered, saving them time and making them more competitive.
Mr. Laurent added that the team was brainstorming for around 6 months before coming up with the idea.
For many years, I've had friends who were mechanics, and just by chance, I happened to be sitting in the store one day and heard a conversation. I need a part. The question was, who supplies this part and where can I get it? How much does it cost? And the mechanic was throwing figures out of his head. So this seemed like a very good idea to bring the network of auto parts suppliers together with the demand to ensure that you can deliver good value to the individuals out there who really need it.
He says even though the team won, the hard work doesn't stop.
The plan hasn't stopped. We continue right along with our development. And as I said earlier, I'm going to walk my shoes off to ensure that we get as many persons using it as possible.
The program was sponsored by the Barbados Coalition of Service Industries and Pitchit Caribbean. President of the BCSI, Wendell Cumberbatch, says mobile technology has taken the world by storm and believes it has enormous potential in Barbados.
It is critical that we recognize that the creative industries and by extension mobile apps has a role to play in the further diversification of the Barbados economy. For us here, mobile apps development can become an emerging industrial subsector with the potential to create more entrepreneurs. All stakeholders need to act in concert and without delay for this to become a reality.
The winning team will now head to the regional leg of the competition in Jamaica.
Opposition leader Mia Mottley says her Barbados Labour Party will be watching every move made by the government. She made that declaration as she spoke to scores of Barbadians who took part in the Walk for Justice today. We hear more from Lisa Lord.
From just after 11 this morning, scores of Barbadians bearing placards assembled in and around Parliament to take part in the opposition Barbados Labour Party's Walk for Justice. Police estimated just over 600 people took to the streets, with messages like "the whole of the north without water" and "taps dry, pockets drier." Those participating in the walk made their way from Parliament around a quarter past 12 along Bay Street, ending at Browns Beach, just a few meters away from government headquarters. It was there that opposition leader Mia Mottley told the crowd that the walk had nothing to do with politics.
This is not about elections. This is not about a victory for the Barbados Labour Party. This is about a movement for people power. And we in the Labour Party will be as subject to it as this government. Because in this year, our 50th anniversary as a nation, Independence will only mean something to people if people can experience freedom and justice.
Ms. Motley says the opposition will be holding the government to the highest level of scrutiny.
And every decision of this government from now on, every bill that is passed, every contract that is awarded, every project that is started without planning permission, every salary increase that is given must be watched, monitored, and responded by the people of this country.
The BLP last led a walk in July 2014, which, according to police estimates, attracted about 3,000 people. The opposition's motion of no confidence in the government was defeated last week, 16 votes to 12. Lisa Lord, CBC News.
Well, we'll tell you what's coming up in and what's in store for the bashment soca genre this year.
Don't let your data experience slow you down. Step up to Digicel, Barbados' fastest 4G network. More than twice as fast as the slow network. Get more with Digicel. Digicel, the fastest 4G network in Barbados. Dial *153 number sign to sign up to Digicel today.
Life happens in a second. And we've seen 5.5 billion of them. 175 years of life's moments, all added up. With every tick of the hand, Sagicor will be there to turn those seconds into decades of prosperity. Sagicor, 175 years of wise financial thinking for life.
Join CBC TV8 this Thursday night at 9:30 p.m. for a repeat of A Tribute to Tony. Hear his views on West Indies cricket, personalities, and some interesting facts about the great man himself in his final television interview. That's a repeat of A Tribute to Tony, Thursday night, May 19th at 9:30 p.m. on CBC TV8.
Barbados can now expect increased bilateral relations with the Republic of Poland. This is thanks to the appointment of Michael Armstrong as the Consul General of the Republic of Poland to Barbados. A consulate has also been set up in Bridgetown. Speaking at the official designation, Mr. Armstrong highlighted what he's hoping to achieve as Consul General.
My focus will be to enhance the bilateral relations between the two countries, particularly in the areas of trade, tourism, education, and culture. And I therefore intend to use my involvement with each of these sectors to identify and progress the opportunities that can be beneficial to both in the short and longer term. My commitment is such that I have commenced initial discussions pertaining to trade and education with the relevant parties of each from a Barbados perspective.
Minister of Foreign Affairs, Senator Maxine McLean, believes there is a lot of potential for cooperation between the two nations.
My ministry is encouraged by the potential for cooperation in other areas between our two countries, such as tourism and security. Also, the government of Barbados continues to be interested in concluding a double taxation agreement with the government of Poland and remains ready to receive Polish nationals as tourists and business travelers to Barbados.
And Poland's ambassador to Barbados, Peter Kasuba, believes Mr. Armstrong will be critical in improving relations.
Mr. Armstrong's personal merits and his experience as an entrepreneur shall strengthen the political, economical, cultural relations between our two countries, as well as the people-to-people interaction.
Well, for the first time, there is a competition exclusively dedicated to Bashment Soca. It is the Barbados Yellow Pages Bashment Soca competition, which will be held on July 1st at the Phenomenal Friday event.
Bashment Soca is a relatively new genre of music that encompasses not just the beat, but the mood and the dance that goes with it. it has become so popular, it now has its own competition. 4D Entertainment and the NCF are the producers of the Barbados Yellow Pages Bashment Soca competition. CEO of the NCF, Cranston Brown, says several artists have been calling for such an event.
For many years, we've been asked to put on a Bashment Soca segment to the Party Monarch, Soca Royale event. But I am very happy to see that a private promoter has now come and put a Bashment Soca competition into the mix. So we always encourage private promoters to get involved. The NCF can't do it all. So we are happy to be a part of it, and we will support it fully.
Host Shane DJ Ras Edwards outlines the entry procedure for the competition.
Everyone who wishes to enter the competition must collect an entry form from the CBC, Caribbean Broadcasting Corporation. They're going to fill up the forms, and they're going to hand back in the forms along with an MP3 format version of their song, which that would entail the competition details. After all the entries are in, a panel of judges would select 12 persons who would be into the semifinals of this Barbados Yellow Pages Bashment Soca competition.
Following the selection of the semifinalists, the public will vote on WhatsApp and Facebook to choose the 6 finalists. Title sponsor Barbados Yellow Pages is also contributing one of the major prizes.
It's a winner-takes-all competition, and we are providing a Kia Picanto valued at $51,000, as well as a cash prize. We are also contributing to promoting the event by way of social media. We are developing all of the social media channels.
98.1 is also one of the event's sponsors, and they will be giving airplay to the songs entered.
We will have that music into rotation on 98.1. As they bring in their music, we will, when the semifinalists are announced, we will make sure we have that music into rotation that all the audience can hear it, and look forward to that show on July 1st, One Phenomenal Friday.
The finals of the event will be held on the night of the semifinals for the Sweet Soca and Party Monarch competitions at Kensington Oval. Sean Farrell, CBC News.
Musical icon and composer of the Barbados National Anthem, Irvin Burgee, continues to make his rounds while in Barbados. Today, he was the special guest at Eagle Hall Primary School.
It was a special tribute to Irvin Burgee at Eagle Hall Primary, the school which also received the commemorative broken trident.
We therefore stand proudly as a nation today that we have our own national anthem, one of our symbols of independence, which identifies us as the nation Barbados.
Mr. Burgee, the American songwriter with a Barbadian mother, told students Barbados has a history to be proud of. And he says the anthem represents a unity he has seen within Barbados for the last 50 years.
I'm so happy to have been a part of it, and will continue to be part of it for as long as I live.
Finance Minister Chris Sinclair says the anthem speaks of the struggle and survival of Barbadians, and he told students he expects the next 50 years to be much brighter.
More than anything else, it says to us, without being boastful, without being arrogant, but under the guidance of the Almighty God, that we can achieve anything. Anything is possible for us Barbadians.
Minister of Foreign Affairs, Senator Maxine McLean, says the anthem is a powerful reminder of what it means to be a Barbadian.
What it is we have achieved, how we've done so, as we heard before, but most importantly, what it is that we need to take us forward. That, in essence, not using the exact words, has been part of the challenge of the Right Honourable Prime Minister as we prepared to engage in this year of celebration.
The commemorative broken trident moved on to St. Boniface Nursery School and then the Belleville Grammar School. Denise Blackman, CBC News.
Moved by the misinterpretation of the term plus-sized, a new pageant has been conceptualized, hopefully, to change the mindset of Barbadians. It's the Miss Plus-Sized Diva Barbados, the brainchild of Judy Boyce, managing director of Kej News. Seven contestants are taking part in the show, and the winner, aside from the various prizes, will represent Barbados at the Miss Plus-Sized Universe pageant in Trinidad and Tobago in August. According to Miss Boyce, the pageant showcases women confident in their skin who love themselves. She says being plus-sized does not mean a person has low self-esteem or confidence or even a threatening health issue.
The term plus-size is used to describe a body type just like short, tall, or athletic. Surrogation is not needed, as we are all human, and it takes all types to make the world. The Miss Plus Size Diva Barbados organization is working tirelessly not only to re-educate the Bajan public that being plus size does not mean lack of intelligence, ugly, or being of bad character. It is simply what it suggests. That person is bigger than what is perceived to be the average size.
Former president of the Barbados Hotel and Tourism Association, Colin Jordan, says the show does not promote obesity. He says there are far too many people performing below expected levels due to poor self-esteem.
It is an area that needs to be addressed by us as a society. I like the detail in the collateral material that I was given, which says, and the brochure says, this pageant does not promote obesity. It goes on to indicate that it is an opportunity for those who some believe cannot be beautiful because of their shape or size to demonstrate their inner and outer beauty while building self-esteem. I think that as a society, it is important for all of us to build the self-esteem of every citizen.
Still to come, we'll have a report from our Peter Thorne in Jamaica at the Board of Governors meeting of the CDB.